Hello, everyone. It's Thursday, October 21st, 2021. I am Solid Blue Sister, and this is my turn to talk. Welcome, Frozen Pizza Fan and 100 Yard Old Chemist. Welcome. I am late. I'm 3 minutes late. But dude, you are like an hour late 2 days in a row. But I'm glad you are here, my friend. Okay, so I'm going to get started and everyone will trickle in. Today, I want to talk about biracial children and race. Do parents of biracial children have the responsibility to talk about race? Should race be a factor when raising a biracial child? Are parents harming the child when race is not discussed? And I also want to throw in, should you talk about race when you're also adopting a child of another race? And I've done that show twice, and each time I've gotten different responses. But I came up with this topic because one of the participants, she texted me an article. And the name of the article, which is on the Huffington Post, it says, like Colin Kaepernick, I wish my adoptive family had talked about race. And it's a very interesting article. And I also know people who are in biracial marriages, and I've, you know, become friends with their children. And it seems that, and again, I'm not biracial, I'm African-American. I did not grow up in a, you know, biracial household. But I do think that children who are biracial, they have a unique, I don't want to say difficulty, but they have to go through things that people who are not biracial don't. And I think, you know, people are always asking, you know, what are you? What do you identify with? And first of all, I want to know, do you think that's a fair question, you know, to ask people? Do you think it's rude? You know, unless someone volunteers, you know, is it rude to say, you know, well, what are you? Or, you know, who do you identify with? And just growing up as an African American and just knowing just some of the issues that, you know, you face just being a person of color, I think that people who are biracial have another, you know, like I said, the other hurdle to cross. So I wanted to know, do you think that biracial children have identity issues? And do you think that parents of biracial children should definitely talk about race, meaning you're half this, you're half that, this is part of your culture, this is part of another culture, you come from, you know, two types of cultures or two, you know, types of people, whatever. Hello, Petty Deb. Welcome back. So, and Crucible Man, thank you. Pegs, thank you for joining. So what do you guys think? Anybody want to take the mic? And I mean, do you think that biracial children have a unique hurdle to cross because they are biracial, because they are probably, you know, being asked, you know, like I said, what are you? Who do you identify with? Anybody want to jump in? Okay, Crucible Man.
Hello.
Hello, Crucible Man. You can start us off.
Yeah, I think they probably do have an additional hurdle anytime, particularly when they're young. You have kids who are different from the rest of their friends or their classmates. Kids being what they are, you know, they're likely to point that out. So I do think it's important for parents to have that conversation. However, I would stop short of overemphasizing the racial identity. I would be fearful that my child would over racialize their identity and maybe see everything through the lens of race. And I don't know that that's particularly healthy later on. I think the conversation needs to be had. Yes, your mother or your father is black or white or whatever the case may be. We love each other. You're here because we love each other. You're just like everybody else. You have two parents who love you. Whatever that conversation sounds like, I think it needs to be had because they are going to be feeling different and they might feel stigmatized. So it's healthy for everybody involved to have the conversation. But again, there's a fine line between having the conversation and having your child be completely wrapped up in their racial identity as opposed to their value as a human being.
Okay, now you bring up an interesting point. You bring up an interesting point. But first, I want to say what Kimma says. He says that conversation does matter because it causes a bit of an identity issue. I think having a firm understanding of both sides of who they are gives them the armor and ammunition to combat the onslaught of opinions. And GP Man, welcome, and welcome PBG 1029. So the problem that I have with saying, oh, mom and dad loves you anyway, you know,
Well, I didn't say anyway.
Okay. Correct me.
Because then you're kind of framing the biracial thing as an impediment of sorts. To say you're biracial, but we love you anyway, implies that there's something wrong. So I did not mean to say anyway.
Okay. No, I don't mean it like that. I meant when you said that, you know, not to emphasize, you know, that they are, you know, half this or half that, you know, whatever it is, half, you know, white Asian, you know, black Asian, whatever. I think that the conversation does need to be had because the bottom line is when you're a child, your parents, they protect you to a certain extent. But then when you go to school, your classmates are going to, you know, tease you possibly. And as you get older, you know, people are going to ask, you know, what are you? You know, what do you mix with? You know, whatever. So your parents, I think, have to prepare you. Unfortunately, you know, it has to happen, but your parents do have to prepare you for having to deal with this conversation. You know, and I guess it goes back to when African-American people talk about, you know, we give our kids the talk. We give our kids the talk for a reason because, you know, we face things that other people don't. So I don't know. And GP Man says, is anyone here biracial? Okay, so anybody here biracial? Okay. Well, I will say that I did invite I don't know if he's going to show up, but I did invite a friend who is, hold on, frozen pizza, and I will give you the mic. I did invite a friend who is biracial. So I'm not sure if he's going to make it today, but he's not here yet. Okay. Frozen pizza. Here we go. All right. So, what did you want to say?
Hi. I'm in. Is it hard to hear me?
No. You are coming out loud and clear.
Okay. Because I feel like it's on speaker, but I can't take it off. But I am biracial, and I do think the conversation is important. And I also agree that it's also important not to overemphasize. But I'm also in my mid-20s, so I was in kindergarten when 9/11 happened, but my race is half white, half Asian. And my dad is Muslim, so I have a Christian first name and a Muslim middle name and a unique sounding last name. But when I was in middle school and especially high school, everybody called me by my last name. But I heard somebody say something about, like, yes, like, people can tease you about, like, stereotypes. Like, if they know I'm not Chinese, but they'll still say, oh, like, you're Chinese. That doesn't bother me. But I just feel like, I think that it's not a bad thing at all. It's unique. And I have seen a few people that are half white, half Asian. And also, my dad is Asian and my mom is white. So I feel like that dynamic plays a role in how I was brought up as well. But to get back to my point, I just feel like identity has only become an issue with the last president, where everything was you're either like in group or out group. So I guess it's just like, yes, coming as an adult too, like I tell my dad that when he was coming to America or like when he was in college, he could always rely on the group of students from his country or just like Arabic speaking people because they did share that common faith of Islam. But myself growing up, I have been to a mosque, but I've gone to a Catholic church way more times because my mom's side. So I think I only consider myself an American. I pass for Hispanic all the time, but Yeah.
So, frozen pizza. Let me ask you: what do you identify more with one than the other?
I feel like yes. I mean, I feel like I identify more with the white side just because that's the family I celebrate all American holidays. Even my father doesn't like. There's no traditional food. There was no teaching of a foreign language. So it would be stupid to say even though I look Asian or just like I look like I'm mixed or non-white, I'm more American than anything.
All right.
Even though I have been to his country and I've been to other cultures. So I realized too that there is a lot more diversity in America, and I saw that at a very young age. So I know that it's different in other countries. I think it'd be more, I don't know what the word is, but more unorthodox in his country than it is in America. My parents had they talked to me, but I think they did say they were both a little afraid when they told their parents like who they're marrying, but they didn't really go into that much detail.
Okay, so frozen pizza, before you go on, because I do want to give other people an opportunity to respond to what you said, but I would like to ask this one question. Did your parents, did they talk about race when you were growing up? Did they say that, you're half Asian.
Oh, half well, white. My mom I feel like this is my perspective, but I think my mom only views me as she's like, oh, I'm white. And if they like know me, she only sees the white side in me. Cause again, like I said, I can pass for like some type of Hispanic in the summer, but in the winter I do like, I lose my tan, but, and I honestly, I can pass her a lot of things, but
okay,
to answer your question, I don't think she doesn't understand too because of how she grew up. I don't think she knew any biracial kids when she was a kid. So.
All right. Thank you for your patience. Frozen pizza is the only one here right now who is biracial. So GP man wants to know, frozen pizza, where did you grow up, if you're willing to share that?
Yeah, not a problem. I grew up in a suburb outside of Chicago. And in my in one of my political science classes, we learned that Illinois is one of the most, when you say America is a melting pot, Illinois is one of the most best examples of that case. So,
okay. All right. Yeah. So, Frozenbees, I'm going to give the mic to someone else. Thank you. And you can jump in again. Does anyone want to comment on, and I'm just going to mute your mic so I don't pick up background noise. Does anyone want to comment on what Frozen Pizza Man said? Anyone want to comment on that? I'm sorry, Frozen Pizza fan. Sorry about that. Does anyone want to comment? Anyone want to take the mic? Crucible Man, did you want to?
Yeah, I had a question for Frozen Pizza fan. Just out of curiosity, did you experience any unpleasantness beyond the normal unpleasantness that kids go through when they're growing up and they're teasing each other for, you know, having glasses, they're teasing them for having braces. I mean, kids can be extremely cruel. Did you experience anything unpleasant on any kind of a consistent basis because of your biracial identity?
Frozen Pizza, you want to answer that one?
Sure. No, I would say, another important thing too is that in eighth grade, I moved from, it was a place that was extremely, extremely diverse, and white people were actually the minority. And there was a lot of Hispanics, a lot of Asians, but I moved to another suburb right next door. And then it was predominantly white, predominantly like mom stayed at home, dad worked. And I just was a little insecure about my middle name because I knew that really set me apart. And whenever somebody would see like my driver's license, they'd be like, wait, what is your middle name? But other than that, no. My African American friends, I remember one time he told me, he's like, you would be great at working at McDonald's. And he worked there. He's like, cause you sound white on the phone, but you're Asian. So people, when they would call me by my last name but my first name, like I said, my first name it's like a Mark Michael. That's my first name and my brother's name too. But people always called me by my last name. And I think it was more just you. I feel like I look pretty unique as well. So I don't think, to answer your question, no one really picked on me, but I am unique. And I think I act a little, not like a class clown, but I definitely like to goof around too a lot. Like the Asian where like it's like be quiet, don't draw a lot of attention to yourself on my dad's side is kind of, I mean, I don't act like that.
All right. Does anybody want to comment on what a Frozen Pizza fan said? Anybody? And Kimis, I saw you put through a request, but if you want to come on, there you are. Okay, Kimis, hello.
Hey, how you doing?
I'm good. How are you? What do you have to say?
So I'm Puerto Rican and black. My father's Puerto Rican and my mother's black. Growing up, I really didn't have an issue with that in school, but I had it inside of myself, if that makes sense. Mm-hmm. And I didn't really know my father's side of my family, but I wanted to know because I wanted to be immersed in that culture. when I got to the military, when I got older, that's when the issues came because I ran into a lot of Puerto Rican people, and I ran into a lot of black people, and I didn't know which side to subscribe to because like I didn't really fit in with the Puerto Rican people because I never really was in that culture. and I fit in with the black people more. So that's where that's the side I lean toward. But it's kind of confusing. If you're not mixed, it's hard to explain, but it's kind of confusing.
Okay, so do you think you, for lack of a better word, I'm sorry if this comes across wrong. Do you think you missed out or anything because you didn't have that Puerto Rican side growing up?
I do because I wanted it so bad. Like, I wanted to go to Puerto Rico when I was a kid. I went while I was in the military, but I wanted to go as a kid so I can experience that life as a child. But never had the opportunity, so it affected me.
Have you connected with any of your Puerto Rican relatives since you've been older, since you've, you know, become an adult?
I have not.
Okay. Okay, is that by choice or you just don't know who they are, or?
I have no idea who they are.
Yeah. Okay. All right. Does anyone want to comment on what Kimma says or anything else? Frozen Pizza, do you want to comment on what Kimma said? Hello?
No,
oh,
I mean,
okay.
I get it that you like have to lean to one side or the other, but for me, and there was a lot of Hispanic people where I grew up too, and if you didn't speak Spanish, or if I don't speak my dad's language, I feel like those people aren't accepting of you. And I feel like a lot of the culture has to do with the language. So that's kind of okay. One thing where I don't see eye to eye with my father on, because I'm just like, I've only dated white girls, one Asian girl too, but mostly white girls and Hispanic, like Mexican girls. But could I see myself marrying a like Asian or even Middle Eastern woman? Yes, but I don't think, especially the Middle Easterns, that they would accept me. And they don't approve of American culture.
So when you went to visit your father's country, how were you treated?
Oh, very good. I went there when I was sixth grade. So I wasn't really a man, but I was treated nicely. I think I was a little nervous then, but like my cousins, my dad has one sister who has three kids and they're like geniuses, but I don't keep in contact with them. And they do ask about me from my mom tells me, but,
okay, so I'm going to throw this question out there. Frozen Man just gave me a just made a question pop into my head. Is there anyone here who would date someone outside of their race, or do you think their family would accept it? Or if your children dated someone, you know, outside of their race, would that be an issue? And if it would be an issue, would it be an issue because you don't know, you know, if you were to have children, that how would your, you know, how do you raise that child? So I hope I'm coming across where I'm not, you know, sounding negative or whatever, but I hope you all understand my question. Sometimes I don't understand my questions, but would anyone, you know, date someone out of their race or even marry someone out of their race, and would your family accept it? Anybody want to take that one? Crucible Man?
Yeah, I'll take that one. Yeah, I think I would. I'm older now, so I think the opinions of people that might have mattered, you know, back when I was 20s, in my 20s and 30s, that may have given me pause. I was too concerned back then what other people thought, my image and things like that, more superficial. And I probably might have been too insecure to do it for fear of what my family, although they're very open-minded, might have thought. But if it were to happen, say, maybe when I was in my 40s or older than that, I wouldn't give a fig. I really wouldn't. I would care more about my own happiness, whether there were children involved at that point, who knows. But I would absolutely go ahead and do it. But I would have been the beneficiary of being older. And I have to say, with all honesty, I'm not quite sure I could have gone through with it when I was younger because I cared too much about what people thought of me.
So, Crucible Man, let me ask you this. Would your family have been a factor in terms of, you know, when you were younger, or even now? Is your family a factor? Is that a consideration that you have if you were to marry someone who was out of your race?
No, not at all. It may have been a factor, you know, with my father back, you know, many years ago. He has many, many black friends. He worked with all kinds of black people. They were over at our house all the time, but he worked for People's Gas, and he worked in some very, very rough neighborhoods. He had partners of his that were killed on the job. He had things thrown at him. I mean, he had some rough times, and so he formed some very hard opinions about certain segments of that community. So I might have been a little concerned with him, but I would not have let any of that stop me. Everybody would have gotten over it, and my happiness is more important than what anybody thinks of me, and I would have gone ahead with it anyway.
Okay, all right. Anybody else want to jump in? And Feisty One, hello, my friend. And what do you want to say?
So, I don't know, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. Honestly, I think Crucible Man is spot on regarding age playing a difference. I think many people care what others think about them when they're younger. It's what you know, it's your comfort level. But as you get older, you're less concerned about what people think about you and more concerned with sort of being true to yourself, right? Having said that, when I was younger, I dated, frankly, many races, right? I didn't necessarily care. Now, I also come from a very diverse family in two regards. My grandfather was white, and he's my grandfather, not necessarily by choice, if you understand the dynamic.
Yes.
And, but I think, you know, when you look, I come from a fairly large family, and when you look at everybody in my family, we all look different and are often or frequently mistaken for other ethnicities, right? And that's okay too. But I think that I always valued who the person was. And I always thought you just love who you love. Like, and I am even, I have that mindset even now. You love who you love. As long as they treat you right. And, you know, now, even saying that, I think, you know, when you talk about having children, there is a different responsibility that comes with that, right? I think you have to think about the culture, you know, and if it's a biracial child, you have to think about the cultures that child comes from, right? Or, you know, that makes up that child. And I think, you know, I think it's important. I think you owe it to them to teach them both sides if it's possible. You know,
why do you say that? Why do you say that you think you owe it to them to teach both sides?
Because it's what they're made of, right? Like, it's just, you know, we don't just have, you know, women don't just have a baby, you know, it takes a partner to make that baby, two different people. And so they are made up of, you know, could potentially be made up of two different races, right? And I think it's just important that they know both sides. It doesn't necessarily mean they'll live both sides, because I think even if you're from an all black family or an all white family or an all Asian family, whatever it is, you tend, you know, frequently based on family dynamics, many people lean toward one side versus the other. And I don't know, you know, probably at times it's based on race, but, you know, at times it could just be based on closeness, right? Like, and so I, you know, being a parent though, my kids have dated outside the race too. And I don't care about that because I told you my grandfather was white. But what I will say is I worry about the treatment of my kids from the families of the person that, you know, my son or my daughter is dating. And that's just the protective motherly instinct. You know, I'll ask a billion and one questions, frankly, like, you know, how do they treat you when you're over there? What, you know, because I'm just trying to gauge, are they treating my kid fairly because they like my kid, or are they making prejudgments about my kid? And so that's what I mean by, if you have a biracial kid, I think it's important that you teach them, or that they learn both sides. I don't know that one parent can teach both sides, but I think that, you know, it's important that they learn or they have exposure to both sides.
Okay. Very, very good points. Does anyone want to comment on what Feisty one says? Anybody want to follow up on that? Chemist or frozen pizza? Do you want to comment? Chemist? Yes, no? Okay. Shy lady wants to come in. All right.
Hey, everybody.
Hello, think, shy lady.
I think Feisty One has a very good point. I don't have any biracial children, but I am the aunt of biracial children. My brother is married to a white woman, and she, I want to say that she, more so than my brother, she goes out of her way to bring the kids around the black side of the family, her husband's side, which is my brother. And she's very, very involved in them knowing their identity on that side. She does spend a lot of time with her family, but it's very important to her for her kids to know both sides, both histories. So she like I said, she's very assertive, and she's, you know, make arrangements all the time to, you know, meet up. Hey, let's go to your mom's house. Let's go see, you know, the other cousins and all of that. So I think it's important that you do make that effort so that both kids will, both of those sides will know, for the children's sake, who they are. And that's important. So I definitely agree.
Okay. So shy lady, let me ask you this. Do you think that, if you are raised in a family where, race is never talked about, that it could be a hindrance when that child gets older?
Most definitely. You know, they, sooner or later, they're going to be reminded anyway. My nephew, I have three nephews, and they're all biracial. And my older nephew, when he was about, I want to say six, he's now 11. When he was about six, one of the kids in school, because they went to predominantly very white school in the beginning, in his earlier years, and some of the kids were like, question, like, what are you, you know, and some of them even were prejudiced even at first grade. And he came home and told his mom, my sister-in-law, several things that, you know, the kids had said, and she got him out of there. She found a school that was much more diversified, and they've had a much better experience in a school that was more diversified. But you know, to see him, he you know, none of the kids look like they're they look like they could, because, you know, it's, race is so different, because some people can look like they may be several different things. And, you know, my nephews are very closer to white looking than they are black, but the kids still were like, you're not like me, you're different. And, you know, kind of holding that over their head, and it just wasn't good for them. And so she decided to take them out, move them to another school.
Okay. And this is why, you know, I say, and, you know, again, we've had these shows before when I talked about, you know, parents adopting, you know, outside of their race. Unfortunately, even though people don't want to, you know, admit it, but race does play a factor when you are dealing either with, in my opinion, when you're dealing with, you know, either biracial or, you know, if you're, you know, I mean, race is just a factor, because sooner or later, that child, whether he's biracial, whether they're all Black, you know, Asian, whatever, they are going to face race. And if you're not prepared, it could be devastating. So does anybody want to follow up on what Shy Lady says? Frozen Pizza or Chemist, do you guys want to follow up on what Shy Lady said? Okay, Frozen Pizza, you have the mic. Thank you, GP Man. You have the mic.
I'll respond to Shy Lady and Feisty One. First, Feisty One, I don't have a problem dating outside my race, and I don't think my parents do at the end of the day either. And I think, I do think with like the rise of social media, even though it is pretty toxic and people are ruthless on the internet, I think you, especially with TikTok, you do see a bunch of other cultures. And I think you are starting to see more people who just look different or look unique. But going back to Shy Lady too, I forgot what I was going to say, honestly, but I think, okay. I think she was saying something about like the size of the family. And I think that does play a role too, because different families view, like different cultures and religions view the family differently. And I think too, also though, just is it different now because both parents and basically every family work. And when my parents were kids, I don't think that necessarily was the normal. So I think it's like with the rise of social media, everything is changing so quickly that it's kind of hard for people, and specifically like older adults, like, I shouldn't say older, but just like my parents' age, you know, mid 50s, it's just harder to adapt to this whole thing about race. I mean, because I do think that the country and the cities are a lot different than like small town America. And I go to a school in the Midwest, in like farm country Midwest, but I've also gone to a college in the South, and I think that people in the Midwest, like Iowa, Nebraska, Kansas, those people think they're like just as country as like people from Tennessee and Alabama. But I think that like, and I know this is going on a different tangent, but I just think that like, I told my dad, I think because the South has like Atlanta and just like the coastal cities, it's better than the Midwest, because farmers from the Midwest think they're like rednecks. And I don't want to be mean, but it's just like, I've met people who graduated with 50 kids in their class from the Midwest and from the South. And I think I prefer the people of the South more than like somebody from Iowa. I don't know why, but, and again, I mean, this whole race thing, as I got older, I always thought I could use it to my advantage, especially for like jobs. And I've worked in a lot of jobs with like customer service or just something where maybe there's like commission or, you know, working at a restaurant. So, you know, I just try to use my, I just try to use my charm to, you know, mess with people. But finally, like Chinese people, like when my dad is from a country called Malaysia, but I remember we got into an argument about using the nuke in World War II. And I'm like, we shouldn't have done that. And I said this as like, maybe high school, maybe middle school. But he's like, no, the Japanese were crazy. And in World War II, they were extremely fascist. So to say that, you know, China doesn't see themselves as like, you know, there's a hierarchy with Asians too. So, and in California, I learned that pretty quickly as well. But I don't want to start saying mean things.
All right. Well, let me say this. First of all, welcome Juju, Zazu. I know I missed a couple of people. Greg, someone else is here that I missed. So I apologize if I'm missing people coming in because people are popping in and out. So, okay. So Feisty One says, are there more racial undertones in the Midwest? So I am going to, I would like to answer that first. And then anyone who is from the Midwest, if they want to jump in, you know, feel free. I grew up in Chicago. I live in California, and Chicago is known as the, even though it is a melting pot and you have all types of different people in Chicago, it is extremely segregated. It is the most segregated city in the North. And Chicago is also known to be the most racist city in the North. And I think that, and I can only, I'm just comparing Chicago, the Midwest, Illinois, to California. So I would say, yes, I do believe that there are more racial undertones in the Midwest. When I went to school, I went to a school in the Midwest. And, you know, there were times when, you know, you go certain places and it's like, you knew you were not wanted there. The school that I, the high school I went to was on the Southwest side, and the Southwest side of Chicago was not, you know, always welcoming. You know, it's like you get in, you get out, you know? So, and then when I moved to California, I was around more Latinos, more Asians, and it was just different. So that's my answer. If anyone else wants to answer, anyone that's from the Midwest who wants to answer Feisty One's question. But Feisty One also completely agrees with frozen pizza. So Shy Lady, you wanted to pop in?
Yeah, being from the Midwest, from Chicago, I will have to agree that there is definitely a difference. I have been in the Dallas area for 20 years, 21 years, actually. Moved here in June of 2000. My husband's employer relocated us here from Chicago. And when I was the whole time I was growing up in Chicago, it was a very, very racist place. And I remember when this was just a couple of years ago, we always usually go visit once or twice a year because we still have a lot of family in Chicago because both my husband and I are from Chicago. I remember we went to this pizza place. I believe it was in I want to say Orland Park. And I think this is about 3 years ago. And the my whole family, my daughter, our sons, and my husband, we were going to this restaurant pizza place in Orland Park, and it was a white man who was rushed in front of us to get into the place, even though we were closer to the door. He like dashed in front of us, very rudely, and he almost stepped on my daughter's toe to get in. He never said excuse me or held the door. And she was like so shocked because where we live in the Dallas area, the white people were very friendly. Oddly enough, they were so different from what, even though that was just a limited experience for her, I've experienced far worse because I lived there for quite a long time. And she was just so shocked because where we moved to in the Dallas area is a telecom area. So there's a lot of transients in the neighborhood from all over because a lot of big telecom companies are in the Dallas area. And you got AT&T, you have Nortel, Cisco, all these big companies where a lot of people come from all over to work. So we had a different experience in the Dallas area because, like I said, the neighborhood we lived in, we had a lot of Asians, a lot of whites, Latinos, people from all over. And just never in the school that the school district is the same way, very a little of this, a little of that, not heavily white dominated. And they were just so different. Even like our neighbors, one of my neighbors that was on the left side of me were old enough to be my grandparents, and they were both white, and they were very Southern in their sound. They had a Texas twang, and they were some of the friendliest people I have ever met in my life. I had my third child in 2004, and I remember my husband used to travel a lot because he was in telecom, and they would come over and say, "Do you need anything? Can we get you something?" Never once did they ever treat me badly. They were always so friendly. And I was so shocked because I have never experienced white people treating me the way they did and the way the others that I've met. Now, don't get me wrong. There are some people that are not perfect here, but for the most part, it was a very good experience in Texas compared to what I grew up with. And as an adult, coming out of college and during my college years, I don't mean to go on and on, but I had a roommate. My first time in college, I had a roommate who was from a rural town in Illinois. I can't even think of the name of it. And she found out I was her roommate, and I went through all kind of hell. She had never been around black people. And I was just amazed. I was used to being around white people because I went to high school with white people and I went to elementary school with white people. But there were lots of people in my college who had never been around black people. And they let you know that I don't like you. They let you know. But that's all I want to say. I don't want to go off, let someone else talk.
All right. So GP Man says, "I'm Latino born and raised in Dallas, never experienced racism in Texas." And again, Shy Lady, you know, coming from the Chicago area, growing up in Chicago, going to school on the Southwest side. I mean, you know, when I came here, you know, it was just, it was different. And when my husband went back to Chicago with me, he was shocked at how it's like, these people are seriously racist, you know? So, you know, Chicago itself is just, because it's so segregated, you know, it's like you have your pockets. You have, you know, the Irish live here, the Italians live here. You know, every city I think has Chinatown, you know, black people live here. I mean, it's like, it's like their territory. And you know, when you're stepping over the line, you know, if you go into Little Italy or something like that. So again, I come back to, because people grow up in these types of environment, is it important that if you are a biracial child, that you do tell people, I mean, that you have to, race is a factor. Race is a factor, and realizing that for some people, you know, race is a factor more so than others. Does anybody want to comment or tell me I'm wrong or comment on what Shy Lady said, or Crucible Man, do you want to say something?
Yeah, I guess I'm kind of curious. I think maybe Feisty One alluded to it a while ago. I can't remember, but maybe Chemist did. At some point, I would think, and not being a biracial person, so forgive my ignorance, at some point, I'm thinking you would have to identify with one or the other, whatever the mix is, Asian and white, black, Hispanic, whatever the mix is, because it's difficult to be two identities, I would think. And I'm just wondering, for lack of a better way of putting this, and I apologize for the inarticulate nature of it, but at some point, do you need to pick a lane? In other words, I have two different parents of two different races, but I can't be a black child and a white child. They're two different cultures and they're two different experiences. I'm just curious, and this would probably be directed at Chemist or Frozen Pizza Fan, since they are biracial. Did you at some point have to make a decision? And I'm guessing your family influences had something to do with it. I know Chemist said that he didn't really see his Puerto Rican side of his family, but was there a point at which you needed to kind of pick a lane and identify as one over the other? Not that you forsake the other, but you just minimize that particular identity in your life? That's just a question I had.
Frozen pizza or chemist? Do you guys want to take that one? Chemist, do you want to take that one? You want to answer that? Wait, hold on here. Chemist?
Yeah. Yeah, so you don't necessarily have to pick a side. I mean, it's pretty much based on like your environment that you grew up in. Like if you grew up in an environment that nurtured both sides, then you're pretty much gonna come up in the middle, depending on how you were raised. Like if you were, it is extremely hard to explain. I have a friend who's mixed. She's I forget what she's mixed with. She's mixed. She doesn't like, you can't really, she looks Asian, but you can't really like tell what she is. And she doesn't subscribe to either side. She just blends both sides well. I mean, it works for her. But for me, I had to, because that's where I grew up. That's what I knew. If I knew both sides, I would probably like have a mixture of both, but I didn't know both sides.
Okay. Frozen pizza, I will give you the mic. So what do you have to say?
I think when you're talking about picking one or the other, it does matter, but I mean, I'm just thinking of all my friends who, like, when I had this girl who was, this friend who was Colombian, and we were really close in elementary school, and they did certain things, like, her older brother and his fiance lived in the basement, the mom wanted the family to stay together, and she would cook dinner at, like, 3:30, 4 o'clock, but... And I could see that the culture was there, but I actually forgot what he asked. But it's just
he was asking, do you ever, you know, at some point, do you find yourself picking a lane? You're either one or the other.
I think what the guy in the military just said is kind of correct too. It's just like, it is kind of like in the both, just because I think like being an American does play a role, but, cause you can definitely tell when somebody's like, even like if they're a kid and they moved to America, like when they were younger, versus if their parents moved here and then they had the kids in America. But, I'd say like I identify with both, but then, you know, living in other cities, I like all the things. Like one of my roommates was Chinese and we didn't really celebrate Chinese New Year, but I do like that, you know, that America talks about like Hanukkah and Kwanzaa and all that. It's not just, even though this is a Christmas country, it's like they do recognize other stuff. So I think that's important and it's helpful. But also, and while I'm talking too, when somebody was talking about how like she wants to understand how her kids are treated, or her nieces, how their parents like want to know how they're being treated, as a kid, oh, this is what I was going to say. I look different now than when I did when I was like 17. Like I only started growing facial hair after like the age of 21. So I think that I look like a completely different person than when I grew up. And it might be facial hair, but I think it is. But I mean, like I was a late bloomer and I think that affects it too, because that, or it just affected me, just like maturing, and then like I don't know, I just don't look like the same kid from high school. So that's another thing too, is I've never really, I haven't interacted with people that I grew up with that much because I moved around. So it's kind of like, yeah.
No, I was going to ask you, can I ask how old you are?
Yeah, I'm 25.
Okay. All right. So does anybody want to comment on what Frozen Pizza or Kim has said or what Crucible Man said or just want to comment, period? Feisty one, you want to say something? Or did you not want to say something? You just, Feisty one, are you there? Okay, I think this could have been a mistake here. Okay, so does anyone else want to comment? Crucible Man, do you want to comment on what Frozen Pizza and Chemist responded?
Yeah, I actually have another question probably for both of them. If they want to answer, that's fine. If not, I understand. Somebody may have alluded to it earlier. I can't remember, but would your experience as a biracial child and as a biracial adult, would that give you any kind of pause in terms of marrying into a biracial relationship? Given, I mean, I think it might be easier today, and I don't really have any data or statistics to back this up, but interracial couples, I think, are much more common today than they were even 20 years ago. You have mixed families. Nobody really, you're always going to have bigots out there, but I don't think anybody really, you know, is caught off guard anymore when they see a mixed race couple out there. So it might be easier to do today than it was back maybe 40 or 50 years ago. But would either of you pause getting into or contemplate getting into a biracial relationship based on your experience as a biracial child or adult?
Okay, I'm going to go to Chemist first. Chemist, would you like to answer that?
No, I would not. I mean, I know how to deal with it. I know how to present it to my kids. So because I went through it. So if I were to date a person of another race or a biracial person, I mean, that's okay with me.
Okay. Frozen Pizza, you want to answer Crucible's question?
Sure.
Okay, go ahead. You have the mic.
It really wouldn't bother me at all. And I know I talked about like dating girls in the past, and I've been single for a while now, and I don't think race affects my dating life. I agree with you that it's more common today, and it's not that big of a deal, but I think like what I've noticed in the Midwest, and I'll be honest, I go to school at the University of Nebraska. So, and the first college I went to was the University of Tennessee. And I think in like the Midwest or just like smaller America, this whole thing of like the cities are going woke and like I worked at a pool as like a head guard or like, which is just like a supervisor, but it was crazy. The things I'd hear like on the sidelines about like kids talking about how, like I've met these two boys who had to be in like sixth or seventh grade, but they were like asking kids in the line their gender. And I think it's more of just like today it's like, are you woke or are you traditional? And I think in people hide behind this religion facade to act how they act. But to get back to your question, no, it wouldn't be a problem because I think that I really want to have, you know, a healthy relationship and like, you know, a strong woman wife. You know, I don't want because that's my parents' relationship. My mom is extremely successful, I think, and she's someone I look up to. But yeah, I think I gravitate towards type A personality women, and I think, yeah, it wouldn't matter with me at all, and I would embrace it, honestly.
Okay. All right. So does anyone else want to make any comments? Anyone else want to take the mic? I know there are people here that are listening. Do you guys have anything that you want to say or add? feisty one. Let's see, you keep popping up here. Shy lady. There we go. Shy lady, did you want to make a point? Hello?
Oh, I'm sorry. Okay. I'm sorry. No, I didn't want to. I'm just listening. I'll let someone else talk. I did a lot of talking today.
Okay. No, I mean, I wasn't sure because your mic kept, you know, going on and off. I wasn't sure what. Okay. So, you know, this is interesting. Everyone has a different take on, you know, various things, about, you know, about race, by racial children, by racial families. And I think what it all comes down to is, you know, we all need to be, you know, tolerant of each other, but at the same time, understand that, you know, people do go through things that some other people do not go through. I was not, you know, raised in a biracial family. However, I do know that if I did marry outside of my race, my father would not have had a problem with it. My mother would have had an extreme problem with it. We have talked about it in the past, and my mother would have had a huge problem with it, but my father would not have. So I don't know. And Crucible Man says people can be intolerant of things they don't understand. Absolutely. Absolutely. And that's where, you know, I come back and say that when things don't happen to you, you know, you tend not to take them seriously, or, you know, just the fact that people have to deal with things that other people don't. And we should be sensitive to that, but sometimes it's hard to be sensitive when it's not happening to you. So once again, everyone, before I wrap this up, does anyone else want to have a parting word, a parting comment? I appreciate everyone's participation as always. Crucible Man, did you want to say something?
Yeah, just to kind of wrap up what I just typed in the chat box. My mother might not have had the best reception to a biracial relationship back in the day, but I think she came over time as she got older, much more enlightened about things related to race. But I do think in general, not just when it comes to racial things, but whether it's men and women, whether it's gays and straights, we don't make enough of an effort to really understand, like you said, what other people go through on a regular basis. If it isn't happening to us, it's not happening to anybody. And I think we could raise our tolerance levels by just trying to understand other cultures a little bit more. You don't have to embrace them. You don't have to celebrate them, but you don't have to dismiss them either. And that just comes from, I think, a feisty one, I think, alluded to it, unfortunately or fortunately, is a product of age. Things that we're not very tolerant of in our 20s and 30s, we become tolerant of as we age and we get, you know, more enlightened and we soften up a little bit. But I think that is at the heart of most racial type of disputes or issues. It's a lack of understanding and a lack of effort of understanding that causes people to maybe distrust each other.
Okay. All right. Well, everyone, again, thank you so much. You guys, the show, this conversation does not work without you. And I appreciate everyone's participation. And GP Man, the show is Monday through Thursday, 1 p.m. Pacific time. So today is Thursday. So this is my Friday. I will not be back until Monday, but I will be posting topics for next week, probably on Saturday. Once again, everyone, this show does not work without you all. And Chemist and Frozen Pizza, I appreciate you guys coming on and sharing and giving us insight on, you know, what biracial life is like. So thank you. So always speak your truth. I am Solid Blue Sister. This is my turn to talk, and I will see you next time. Bye. Juju, Francis, PBG, thank you. Shy Lady, as always, thank you. And Feisty One, you guys, thank you so much. Kimis, I am so glad you got here today, even though I was late. I was late by 3 minutes, but thank you for showing up. Crucible Man, as always, thank you. And everyone, thank you for liking the show. Thank you. Oh, and if you guys could you guys, can you guys leave some comments? That also helps my algorithm. I know that's shameless for me to ask, but if you guys could leave some comments, you know, please. So thank you. Thank you. But I do like this little group we have. I hope to expand it, but for the regulars, you know, thank you for the new people coming on. People have something to say. Kimis is giving me a thumbs up. Wow. Thank you, Kimis. Feisty One says, I'm shameless. Right? I have to harass people to leave me comments? Yep. Uh-huh. I'm shameless. I'm proud of your growth. Oh, Kimis, thank you. Thank you. And Juju's laughing. Hey, you know, I could ask for money and have a little, you know, bucket out there for money, but I'm just asking for comments. Okay, y'all. I'll see you on Monday. Bye.